Cooper Webb, and I choose OGIO.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Dean Wilson.
I'm Aaron Plessinger.
I'm Jerry Martin.
I'm Nate Thrasher.
I'm Shane McElrath.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
My name's Jet Lawrence.
I'm Jordan Smith.
I'm Tal Hawkins.
Stargate Hampshire.
I'm Hayden Deegan.
I'm Colt Nichols.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Tom Diala. I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Jiren Ferrangis.
And I choose OGIO.
All new Yamaha YZ450F. Narrower, more compact, and lighter. Built to do one thing, go faster.
Hey guys, welcome to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Today I'm joined by one of my early career heroes, Jeff Chicken Matiasevich.
How you doing?
You came and did a show with us before.
Yeah,
and then we've done some other stuff, but I've always really got a kick out of hanging out with you because you were like one of the dudes when I first started out at Cycle News.
Yeah.
At my job and all that, but it's been a pleasure seeing you ride so much still around Southern California. I mean, you're always at the tracks. Not recently,
yeah. But I'm getting back though. I started riding again, so.
Oh, you have?
Yeah.
Okay, so most recently Chicken broke his neck, right? In a crash at Glen Helen.
Yeah.
How long ago was that?
That was like 3 months ago.
3 months ago?
Yeah, so they put two rods and bolted it together.
Wow.
And then
it split back open.
And like, then it split back open a week later after surgery. I had to go back in and have surgery again, the whole thing all over again. And It was sort of a nightmare.
So broken neck at
Glen Helen.
You're in your 50s now, right?
Yeah.
Was that your worst injury you've had on dirt bike?
Not the worst, but it was scariest, you know?
Yeah.
For sure, it made me think a little bit. I never had a injury where, you know, you could be paralyzed or whatever. You
know? Yeah.
Broken arms and legs and stuff like that. It's not that scary, but made me sort of think, but.
I mean, was there ever, I'm done riding?
No.
No.
No, I drove myself to the hospital, and on the way I'm driving down the road, I'm like, shit. What do you think about 3-4 months I'll be able to get back on the bike? You know, I was already thinking that the way to the hospital. So,
Right on. Okay, so we paid a visit to you a couple months ago when Fox came out with that new.
I finally get to wear the gear.
Oh, have you worn it yet?
Yeah, once, yeah.
Nice. Yeah, so we paid a visit to you at Vegland.
Yeah.
And got to go to lunch, and you had all these crazy stories for us, right?
Yeah.
But I was like, thinking about it, I'm like, we got to share these with some people. Like, I was really intrigued by the Japanese championship years.
Yeah.
Because so after your U.S. Racing career had kind of tapered down, you got a call to go race for Factory Kawasaki in Japan, correct?
Yeah, I was sort of at the point, I didn't know if I wanted to retire or keep going. I was at that stage, and Kawasaki called and told me, asked me if I want to go to Japan. And it was only, they race over there, I think 12 or 14 races a year. Mm-hmm. So it was a good deal. So I'm like, oh, for sure. And it turned out to be a great experience.
Yeah. Isn't it kind of weird to you that like Japan is where four of the manufacturers are, four of the seven, or soon to be eight or nine, right?
Yeah.
But still, motocross isn't hugely popular there. Like, what was your interpretation of it when you got there? What were you expecting? And
well, I've been out there before. We go every year for two supercrosses over there. And so I knew what to expect, you know. Mm-hmm. It is not as popular as in the States. And I think that's mostly because the lack of land to ride, you know. Mm-hmm. I think Kawasaki was the first. They brought Eddie Warren over originally, and then Suzuki fired back and brought I think Ron Tischner was the next one to come over to compete with Eddie. And then Ronnie beat Eddie, and then that's when they brought me over to replace Eddie. So,
So when you got there, what was the reception like from the Japanese fans or industry even?
From Kawasaki, I mean, they didn't. I don't think they really. They didn't know what to expect from me. I think they heard stories about me, and like I said, I've been over there for 3 or 4 years with Kawasaki for the Supercrosses every year. So I knew a few of the Japanese over there, but I think they were a little worried about maybe what they were told about, you know, being a little crazy or wild or whatever. Like, you know, they're very reserved, if you will. And I couldn't go anywhere by myself. I had a babysitter the whole time.
Really?
I think they're a little worried.
Okay, what was the adaptation of the tracks and stuff like? Because they're a lot smaller and they're not as.
There's some a couple good tracks, you know, really good tracks. There's some smaller ones. They don't have the heavy equipment like we do here to prep and everything. But there are some good tracks. A lot of rain though. A lot of rain over there. So. I learned how to ride mud.
Yeah. What do you think? Like, is some of the best performances by Japanese riders visiting have been at mud races, like Narita at the rainy one? Like, it's almost like you have to ride in the rain there all the time because they race so much.
Yeah.
So when you were in Japan, did you practice in the rain and test in the rain?
I tested a little bit. I flew back and forth for every race, so I wasn't actually there really that much. But, there were probably like almost half the races were sort of had some rain.
Wet.
Yeah. So.
How many seasons did you race over there?
Three. Yeah.
All right. You're telling me the story about your boss and you'd say, what, maybe fired?
Yeah. So every time I'd be doing something and screwing around, you can buy fireworks everywhere. So I'd always buy bottle rockets and we go out to dinner and then I'd leave dinner before everybody was done. I got in the parking lot and I just start shooting these bottle rockets at everybody as they came out of the restaurants and stuff. And so every time I sort of got in trouble, I'd look at my boss and be like, maybe I'm fired, you know? And he'd be like, he'd either tell me, maybe so, or I don't think so, you know, if I got in a little bit of trouble. So we were at a race and like six of the Kawasaki bigwigs showed up. Yeah. And it's like 100 degrees out and they're in three-piece suits and they're all 70, 80 years old. And after the race, they were getting ready to leave and they all came in a van. And so I was a little bit of ways away and I fired a bottle rocket into the van. Adam just to screw with them, and it got stuck right in the door where you open up the door and the door jam there. It got stuck and caught the van on fire, and just all these old men come rolling out of the van, hit the ground, and my boss was standing behind me, and I turned around, I looked at him, I'm all, maybe I'm fired, and he's like, maybe so. And then they all laughed, ended up laughing about it, so yeah. It wasn't that bad.
Nice. Hey, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. We'll be back for more chicken. Everyone, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. One of the kicks I got out of our first show together is I was like, hey, Chicken, who is your biggest rival? Was it, you know, and the subject of Bradshaw came up, right?
Yeah.
And you were telling me how, like, you guys were bitter rivals and you still don't talk and this and that. And you told me that funny story about his wife inviting you to his birthday party or something.
Yeah, surprise birthday party.
But the funny thing about that is I was like, hey, so like if Bradshaw showed up at Milestone next Wednesday, there'd be beef. And you're like, oh yeah, the sparks would fly.
Yeah.
But then a few months later, I think was it a fly ride day or something?
It was something.
People were at Paris and Bradshaw eats shit.
Yeah.
Clipped his bars on that wall.
Yeah.
And got hurt. And then lo and behold, who helps him get back to the truck is you and Jake, right?
Yeah. I went out and he jumped in behind me. We went a couple laps and we were going back and forth. And then there was a tabletop and he just pretty much jumped off the track. I mean, I didn't have anything to do with it. I didn't force him or nothing. But he crashed really bad. And so I spun around and actually gave him a ride back to the track.
Did he break both his arms?
Two broken wrists, yeah.
Yeah.
It was sort of different, you know. If I would have put him down, I would have left him there. But since I really didn't have nothing to do with it, I helped him out and gave him a ride back.
So when you guys were at the track at the same time after all these years, did you talk before you started riding together?
No.
He just jumped on behind you. What goes through your head when Bradshaw?
I mean, I knew it was probably going to happen, you know. Because as soon as I got there, everybody's like, hey, Bradshaw's here. You know, uh-huh. I'm like, fuck. So I knew something was going to probably go down. But as far as us getting together and going at it.
So he's laying there all wadded up, broken wrist.
Yeah.
You ride back up. You're like, hey, you want to ride?
I just spun around. I said, hey. And he, you know, he's like sitting there and he's like, you know. And I'm like, jump on back. I'll give you a ride. You know, and
have you talked since, or did you talk at the truck, or
no?
That was it.
I gave him a ride back to where he was parked. And he jumped off, and I haven't
heard from him since. Oh wow! Still, it's funny. My friend Wayne Ashby was there, and he sent me phone video of you guys riding together, and we ended up chopping it up and making it into video, like Chicken and Bradshaw race again, ride again, and then at the end. You're riding him back on the back of your bike. And a lot of people went nuts over it, you know?
Yeah.
But that's pretty funny. That's all there was to it.
Yeah, it was his mistake. And
all right, so who's faster before you crashed?
We were sort of going at, I mean, same speed, nobody was really faster, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, Paris, I know that track
quite
well. And I don't know how many laps he'd gotten on it, but...
That was when they first changed the jump in the back, and it kind of did aim at the wall a little bit.
Yeah, you sort of, I was on the, I think I went inside, he went outside, and then he hit the tabletop. I was pretty much right next to watching him the whole thing, and he just cartwheeled.
Yeah. Okay, so these days, you're riding a KX 450.
Yeah.
Are you riding an SR or a standard one?
Mine's, I guess, the standard one.
Yeah.
I did all the testing for the SR on the suspension.
Yeah.
But yeah.
What do you think about, like, from the days when you were a teenager riding and stuff, to think about what you could buy now, right?
Yeah.
The KX450 SR, the way it comes
and
everything. And so you're well aware of, you know, the engine upgrades, suspension upgrades.
Yeah.
Like, pretty cool, don't you think?
I mean, it's cool, but I mean, it's so expensive, I think, at the same time, you know? I mean, I mean, amateurs these days, you know, amateur kids, you usually have like, say, three bikes, you know, practice bike and then stock and modified bike, you know, and how they afford it, it's crazy, you know? I mean, we used to get bikes for, you know, we were just talking. I mean, my first bike was a XR80, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember it was $400.
Yeah. Okay. So, and your brother just bought a KX250 yesterday?
Yeah.
And it was?
It was $11,121.
Oh, man. It's crazy. But I mean, Do you think it's proportionate to the cost of living back then to now, or have dirt bikes just gotten more
expensive? I mean, I think the quality of the dirt bike and what you get,
the technology
and everything that you get now compared to back in the day, it is a big difference, you know. But it's definitely. I mean, I miss two strokes. I really don't like four strokes.
Really?
I hate them. Mm-hmm. I'd rather be on a two stroke, but Kawasaki don't make one. So.
Yeah. What's the last two stroke you had? Like a 06?
98.
98 was the last two.
Wait, no. Yeah.
No, they
the
made
last
a
year. Whatever last year they made them.
Yeah. So were you begrudgingly taking home the 450 the first time?
Yeah, I mean, I just couldn't ride. I still can't ride them very well, I don't think, you know. I mean, I think if on a two-stroke, I'm a lot faster. On a four-stroke, everything, all the technique, everything to carry that momentum and all that, you don't have to do that on a four-stroke. You just sort of twist the throttle, gear up. And
what do you think it's done for racing at the highest levels?
I don't know if it's brought people closer, I think maybe a little bit. Because if you think about it, in the two-stroke days, there was always like two guys that were dominated, and then there was a big gap back to the third.
Yeah.
Now it seems like everybody's a little closer, you know. But privateer guy can definitely compete with the factory guy now.
Yeah, look at like Ty Nashville this year.
I mean, the bikes are a lot closer. Because now, I mean, you got so much power that they're actually detuning them to slow them down a little bit, you know?
Yeah. Hey, did you ever get to race a True Works bike in the U.S.?
In the U.S., no.
Yeah. In Japan, you did, though.
In Japan, I had
one. What was, like, the craziest one you rode? Or, like, was there anything that was, like...
Probably my... what was it? My 96 bike is when it went all... computerized with mappings and all that stuff. I was over there in 95, and then 96 I went over to test, and that's when they started plugging in the computer saying, what do you want, and then okay, go. And I'm like, you didn't change a part, you know.
Yeah.
I'm like, don't worry about it, just go, you know. And that was probably the craziest bike, because that technology had came in and it wasn't here in the States, you know.
That would have been pretty cool to race something that was like...
It was really cool, yeah. I mean, my race bike was, I think, 8 years ahead of production or something like that. 3 years ahead of the works bike, the U.S. works bike, 3 years ahead of that. So it took a while to get used to when I, you know, get there, practice, and then there was a qualifier. And then by that time, I'd start to get used to it.
Yeah, right on. Hey, Jeff, we're going to take one more quick break to hear from our sponsors. Be back for more. We'll be right back. Everyone, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Here with Jeff Matiasevich. So, when your racing career in Japan came to a close, what did you do? Was there that strange period of adaptation for you where you're like, what do I do? Or
well, it was sort of unexpected. I got fired, I guess, after winning three championships in Japan.
Oh, because they said no more Americans.
The four manufacturers got together and basically, hey, we need to weed out the Americans. And so my contract was up. So they said, we don't have anything for you, you know. And so I came back home and I was like, okay, do I really want to go back to racing here in the States and race every single weekend? And I was like, no, I don't, you know, I'm done. So, but then, Kawasaki called. So one of the Mitch Payton's guys got hurt over PC. And so they're like, hey, you want to come back and ride the 125 class? And I'm like, yeah, sure. Okay. But I had like, it was a month before the first race and I hadn't been on a 125 in years. Yeah. And, I was actually like, I was like 205 pounds at that time. And, so I lost, I mean, I got down to like 165 in a month. I mean, I didn't eat. I didn't eat. I just started training. I didn't eat. Uh-huh. I could lose weight really quick. But so when I got on the bike, I was real heavy. And so I did, you know, the West Coast Supercross. And then I broke my kneecap, so I didn't get to finish it. But I did okay.
That's crazy. I don't remember that.
Yeah.
How did you do? Like, what was the best finish you had?
I think fourth.
Fourth?
Yeah.
And so after you broke your kneecap, then that
was done. That was it. Yeah.
But like, you know, sometimes, you know, professional athletes when they retire, they have that like the emotional trouble. Of, like,
no,
like,
I didn't have none of that.
You were just like, yeah.
I'm done. You know, I mean, in my mind, I mean, I had a good career, a pretty long career for as far as motocross goes. So I don't have any regrets or, you know, I mean, I don't miss the traveling, you know. Yeah. I mean, I like to just go ride and have fun and go home, you know. Uh-huh. It's good enough for me.
All right, so on my drive here to the studio, I was thinking about memories I have of you and add photos or whatever. Yeah. And so like, I'm just gonna ask you some random stuff, right?
All right.
So like, I remember the extreme ad where you're on a Suzuki.
Yeah.
250 Suzuki and you're in the extreme gear and all that. Uh-huh. What was that era like? Like, were those bikes good?
Suzuki?
The 250 Suzuki?
It was a pile of shit. It was fucking horrible. When I went into them, I was thinking about retiring and, so I didn't do anything for like a month. And then I was like, you know what? I still want to race. Mm-hmm. But it was like Anaheim was coming up. There was a couple months before Anaheim. And so Suzuki's in Breda by where I live. So I just drove down there and I walked in. I'm like, hey, you know, I want to ride next year. You guys got anything? And so they put something together real quick for me. And I told them, I go, I don't want to sign this contract unless you guys promise me that, you know, we're going to be doing, we only got a couple months, but we do. At Kawasaki, we did a lot of testing, And I knew the bikes, Suzuki's weren't that good. So I said, you know, we do testing. And they're all, oh, yeah, yeah. Japan stoked, you know, full support. I picked up the bikes and they gave me a 2-cylinder and 3 pipes and said, we'll see you at Anaheim. And I'm like, no. What? I mean, really? Yeah. And that was the extent of testing, was 2 cylinders and 3 pipes.
Oh, wow.
And the front end, the head stay in the front end used to twist really bad. So you jump into something and hit something real hard, it would just go left or go right.
Oh, no.
I mean, Hal Cooper and rode those things as fast as he did. It was pretty amazing.
Yeah.
It was
another image of ad comes to mind is, I think it was an Oakley ad. And you had your iguana on your head.
Okay, yeah.
That was cool. But you've always had a lot of reptiles, right?
Yeah, I've always had a lot of reptiles. And Yeah, so we threw one on my head, and I had this weird Troy Lee hat on.
It was that like one with the hair, right?
Hair, yeah.
Yeah.
And with iguana sitting up there, yeah.
Was that a planned out thing beforehand, or?
No, that was just.
You just brought it to the shoot?
I forgot how that, I think, I don't know. Yeah, that was like just, I don't know. Maybe I had it in the truck or something, who knows?
Yeah. All right, this one's kind of weird. I remember, I don't know if it was an ad or if it's like a big picture in Troy's office or something, but you're like naked and you have the helmet on your dick.
Yeah.
Now, was it taped there or did you get hard?
No, it was at Washougal.
Uh-huh.
And I don't know how it came about, but anyway, so we went up in the walking the track or something, and so we like go off to go like where no one could see really, you know? And there's some kids following us, and I'm like, you know, hey, get out of here, you know, get out, because we're going to do the photo or whatever. And so I hung my helmet on my dick, and we took a picture. And Troy had a big, big picture of it behind his desk forever.
Was there a photo assistant that helped you?
No.
Oh, no.
Just me, the photographer.
Yeah. So through the years, you've had a lot of iconic looks, right? Like I always think of you as a super stylish rider. You had the barbed wire gear that Fox just did, and then you had that really cool Showy replica that I'm sure is one of Showy's all-time bestsellers.
It is, yeah, it is.
But like, what was like one of your favorite eras of as far as looking dialed?
I mean, you know, I got to give credit to Pete Fox for but I always cared about how I looked, you know. I mean, if I wasn't going to win, I want to look the best at least, you know. But and a lot of the riders, you know, we show up on the line and they got stains on their jersey, and it's like, dude, you're a factory rider. I mean, come on, you know. So I always, you know, designed my helmets sort of go with the gear, and Troy always painted me awesome helmets. So always, for as a kid, when I, you know, grew up watching everybody, you know, I always liked Bailey, O'Mara, because they looked all stylish and cool.
All dialed,
you know?
Yeah.
It wasn't so much if they won or not. It's like, I like those guys because they look cool, you know? So that's sort of the route I went. I wanted to, you know.
You missed the open face era, huh?
Yeah. I never worn one. Ever.
It's funny now to think about wearing an open face and how horrifying.
I mean, I didn't miss it. I just started out in a full face.
And, yeah.
I mean, my first probably 2 years on Cali, Wardy still wore the open face. And I was, dude, you got to get rid of that thing, man. You know?
Bust your teeth.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I just used to think it looked so cool. Another ad that was really impactful for me when I was little was Oakley used to have the ads where the guys would put their helmets and everything on, and they'd shoot them sideways.
Yeah.
So, like, Wardy would have the Oakleys with the nose piece.
Yeah,
the,
that the Jofa thing, yeah.
Yeah, and then O'Mara would have the JT mouth trap.
Yeah.
I thought that was so cool and dialed looking, you know?
Yeah.
But it's just funny to think that guys race like that.
It's pretty crazy, yeah. They still have a face, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I guess they're not riding 450s like we are now. I mean,
still.
450s have caused the goggle manufacturers to change the way they make goggles safer.
Yeah,
because the lens can get blown out.
It hurts.
Yeah,
I get pissed. I like want to kill the guy in front. It's not his fault. He's just riding, but you know, you catch a big roost, and you're like, I'm gonna kill that guy.
So, you're getting back on the bike now.
Yeah.
From your crazy broken neck.
Yep.
What does the rest of 23 have in store for you? You have any plans or?
No.
Just as much fun as possible.
Day by day kind of guy.
Dude, I thought it was so funny when I moved to Corona. I was just like, wow. Because I came from Valencia.
Yeah.
And I'm like, wow, there's so much motocross industry here, you know?
Yeah.
And it seemed like when I moved to Corona, I literally ran into you. Like,
I see you everywhere. I still do. Like, all the time. I mean, we had lunch a while back, and the next morning, you know, I see you two guys.
But I just thought it was so funny. Because then there was this one day, I was like, I gotta go to the grocery store. I just grabbed something, and I didn't have my contacts in because it was late at night. I could drive down. There was no contacts, and I drove down, and I bought something. I was walking out, and you came walking in, and I had my contacts weren't in.
Yeah.
And I think you were wearing some old like pants from the 90s, like these big baggy balloon pants. And you're like, hey, dude. I was like, who's that homeless guy? I'm like, oh, it's Chicken. What's up?
Yeah.
But I don't know. It's sure been, it's been super cool for me to run into you and and see you all the time and ride with you. And,
Home Depot, but, post office.
You know, I mean, dang.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm living the motocross dream, right? Because like when I first started, you were the guy, and I was like, Chicken. And
I remember your brother telling me, hey, my little brother's working for Cycle News.
Yeah, so I don't know. Anyway, dude, it's been a pleasure.
All right, it's been
thanks
great.
For coming in today.
No problem.
And guys, thanks for watching, and like and subscribe, and we'll see you next week.
Peace out.